Good morning, everyone, and welcome back to theCUBE's live coverage of Red Hat Summit Ansible Fest 2025 here at the Boston Convention Center. I'm your host, Rebecca Knight, alongside my co-host and analyst, Rob Strechay. We're both fresh from the keynotes, the main stage, where we had the who's who of Red Hat, Matt Hicks, Chris Wright, Stephanie Shiras, along with a lot of great customers. We're going to be talking about what was talked about all day long.
Absolutely. I think we have a sesh on this morning as well. And I think it's going to be a banner 2 days left here, wall to wall. Lots of partners, lots of good customers on stage. And, you know, that's, I think Red Hat does that really well with their partnerships. So I'm really happy to kick it off with that.
They do indeed. And a perfect segue to introduce our next guest. We have Chris O'Brien, Senior Technical Marketing Director at Cisco. Welcome to the show, Chris.
Thanks for having me. Yeah.
And Todd Brannon, Senior Director Ecosystem Solutions at Cisco. Thank you so
much. Great to be back in the CUBE.
Love
the CUBE.
Distinguished CUBE alum.
The pulse of the industry right here.
Absolutely.
Thank you for saying that, Todd. Yes, I still see. So I want to start with you, Todd. The Cisco Red Hat partnership goes back decades, and it has only broadened and deepened over time. Why don't you talk a little bit about the history of it and where you are right now in terms of what you're working and how you work with Red Hat?
I mean, the history, I think, really traces the impact that Red Hat's had on the industry over time, right? Because you basically harness that immense power of an open source ecosystem and all those contributors, but you harden it, you support it for the enterprise, and so they kind of play a critical role, and they've played a critical role for a long time. They've been woven into all of our solutions over time, you know, originally with networking, compute as we got into that, security. So they're really intrinsic to all the solutions that we've
actually done a lot of work, you know, heavy work in the OpenStack days, you know, now we're into OpenShift. But I think to Todd's point, you know, when you partner with Red Hat, which we have a great partnership with, you know, they're led by the community, and that kind of drives through to the enterprise, right? And that's how, you know, I think the solutions that we bring to the market really are, you know, striking a chord, so.
Yeah, I think one of the things we're hearing this week so far has been really around application modernization and having a platform for that. And one of the partnership places that you guys are interacting is around app modernization. Why don't you kind of give us a little bit of that?
Yeah, that's kind of the meat and potatoes, right? So, and we heard about some of those things where we intersect in the keynote today. Really our objective, you know, what we're doing at Cisco is really building out infrastructure for large scale enterprise IT, public sector, right? And everything that we heard about today really goes along the lines of simplifying that for our customers, right? So an example, you know, the image mode in RHEL 10 may not be scintillating dinner conversation with your family, but if you're having dinner with a DevOps engineer, it is scintillating conversation, right? Because all the things that we're going to talk about around AI are built on these DevOps processes, and immutable infrastructure is key to that, right? So why muck around trying to turn the knobs on a deployed operating system? That's inherently risky, right? So being able to package this up and deploy it, swap out the whole package in one go, that's an example of what Red Hat's doing to bring these kind of capabilities that enterprise IT need to operate at this kind of scale.
And if you think about it too, it aligns really well with our security story. So if you think about all the work that we're doing, if you had something like an immutable operating system and then you layer on it, you know, the complete offering from a Cisco stack per se, you know, if you get that, I think just the combination is you know, better together for us. You know?
Another pillar of this partnership is AI-ready infrastructure. And this is as so many organizations and enterprises are going from sort of science experiments and exploration, experimentation to needing mission critical ready apps. Can you talk a little bit about what you're doing there?
Sure. Again, it's all about predictability and scale. So the VLLM and LLMD is just crucial for that, right? Because you know the memory inside a GPU is expensive real estate, right? So we have to optimize the way we can use that, especially for inference, because inference is the point of delivery for all this AI work, right? That's where it all comes together. Like you say, this is where, you know, this is going to get baked into mission critical applications. We heard that from Turkish Airlines right on stage this morning, what they're doing for their customers. And so this kind of technology allows you to wring more value out of your investment in your accelerators. And then being able to, you know, the days of the vertical monolithic application are gone, right? Modern applications are these constellations of microservices. And so being able to scale out horizontally is essential. So that's what that, you know, LLMD piece is doing for us, helping us spread this across multiple nodes. So it's really just it's Red Hat taking the lead to bring really important capabilities in to help our enterprise customers scale, secure, get predictability in their AI deployments.
And I think too that what we kind of bring to the table is a very uniform approach. So if you adopt a Cisco type infrastructure, you really can adopt an infrastructure that's fit to the purpose. Are you doing inferencing? Are you doing fine tuning? Or is it a training environment? Which means we're right sizing it. We're also making it accelerated deployment, meaning if we give you the guidance, right, best practices, if you provide you the automation, which we're doing a lot of work with Red Hat in that space, that allows you to, quickly roll it out, and really take advantage and get the value that you're trying to get out of AI. So a simplified approach, fit to purpose, and it really maps to all the different AI workloads that are coming.
Yeah, it would seem like, inference, we have a kind of a law around the distribution of Gen AI, and we see that the long tail is really going to be inference, and that's where the bulk of workloads. Is that what you're seeing in your customers?
Absolutely.
Where they're going to production is really around inference, and it's not all in the cloud. There's a lot happening. I mean, we see people bringing AI to the data versus other way around.
There's always that pendulum between on-prem and cloud, and our observation is that AI is going to start to push that pendulum a little bit more toward on-prem. Customers, like we heard today, they're building out these multi-tenant, for lack of a better word, it's a private AI cloud, right? They need multi-tenancy. They want to keep their data at home. So all the things we're talking about here at the show kind of enable that. Think about all the things that we've developed from a CVD standpoint, our validated design program.
So Cisco validated designs, we, co-engineer, with our partners like Red Hat, storage partners, et cetera, NVIDIA, to develop different solutions. So our AI ready infrastructure is really built with these, different technology partners coming together, getting the best practices there. So, we've done things, RAG solutions, obviously we've done, medical inferencing, more predictive analytics type solutions, and we've also done it with and without GPUs. I mean, the reality is that, customers have to right size that infrastructure for the use case. AI inferencing is something that's really going to be pushed out to the edge. And, if GPU is required, Cisco's going to be there, from an infrastructure perspective and allow, Red Hat to do what they do best, which is really manage it through an OpenShift AI type deployment.
So, and one of the things you kind of mentioned on and hit on is another one of the pillars, which is security.
That's right.
I think that also, as you go out to the edge, as you push inference out there, What are you guys doing together in the security space?
We have a very simple philosophy at Cisco. If it's connected, it's protected, right? And because really there is no perimeter anymore, right? We have to build security into the network, period. The days of separate technology domains there are really ending, and Cisco is really uniquely positioned to bring security and embed it in the network, like what we're doing with our Hypershield product and our AI defense products are all about embedding security throughout the network. And these AI applications expose the absolute living soul of a business to the world. And if they're not secured, you're in big trouble. So we made a really important acquisition in iSurveillant and their Cilium technology. And honestly, and I don't use hyperbole a lot, but they brought unprecedented capabilities to kind of the observability and runtime security in a container environment. And that investment and bringing them into the fold is really helping, especially with Red Hat, the integration work that we're doing there. I can't pre-announce it, but on that topic at Cisco Live 3 weeks from now, you're going to hear some really interesting things from iSurveillant. And it kind of touches on another thing that we heard in the keynote this morning, which is customers looking at their virtualization strategy. It's really critical for people to understand if they're trying to reduce their exposure to Broadcom, right, to be blunt about it. OpenShift is a really good alternative, and so we've recently done a lot of work to run OpenShift on bare metal, right? So if you think about the current paradigm, most customers that I talk to are still running OpenShift on top of VMs. Well, if we flip the script there and really go for, hey, here's a UCS server running Core OS, yep, running OpenShift, you can now serve both VMs and containers, and there's two things that does for your cost, right? One, you're stripping out the VMware subscriptions. And my Red Hat friends may not like me saying this, but there's a little known element in the subscription schemes with Red Hat where it's more efficient to run it on bare metal, OpenShift on bare metal, than it is necessarily on VMs, right? Because when you're running on bare metal, you're basically being licensed by the socket, right? And I think it's up to 128 cores, all you can eat, versus if you're running on top of a virtual machine, it's a subscription is more a per core basis. So
I don't think they're going to mind you.
I mean, just knowing if you're looking to bring down your cost of OpenShift, run it on bare metal, right? And you get kind of a double factor effect here.
We're also integrating with this, right? So
correct.
We have integrations with our InterSight platform, which is our cloud-based management platform for our compute. So at scale, you know, cloud scale, you can manage your infrastructure. And now we have integrations, so you can bring up CoreOS quickly and easily, so you can extend your environment. So, you know, we're trying to be uniform in how we manage these infrastructures. But I think, you know, for us at Cisco, just to be, you know, point blank, we want to enable our customers to go where they want to go. And if it happens to be OpenShift virtualization, or they want to stay with Broadcom, or what it is, we want to bring, you know, bring the same consistent approach to the fabric as well as to the compute.
So. Well, I'm interested, both of you have a deep background and expertise in this area. And I'm curious, if we sort of back up 10,000 feet, how you've seen these ecosystem solutions evolve over recent years, and both in terms of what customers are demanding of you, and how you work with partners to deliver.
Well, I think obviously we're seeing a lot of customers come to us with, we need different choices for hypervisors, different alternatives. So we're certainly trying to address that, working with Red Hat for sure. That's one of it. I also do see, you know, we do see a lot more software-defined storage solutions. If you look at AI, you know, there's a lot of new players in the software-defined storage space that are coming up. So, you know, Todd being my ecosystem partner and friend in crime, you know, he's bringing, you know, some new names that we traditionally haven't partnered with. And, you know, I think you'll see some of that coming out at Cisco Live and some of our past, you know, like Voss and things like that. So, you know, we were talking earlier before we started, like, there's a different opportunities for this generation, right? And we're seeing different opportunities for Cisco and for the solution space. And the ecosystem, I think, is just growing faster, maybe, you know, than we've seen in years, to be honest with you.
I think we're seeing architecturally just more fragmentation and just more moving parts, both at the fundamental server architecture level and up through the stack. So, you know, one of the things we like to say about our approach to computing that's very different is UCS, it's not a server, it's a system. And you mentioned InterSight, and that's really the heart of it, and the integrations that we can do across the ecosystem and basically help our customers harvest all this innovation that's coming from the industry, but not have to figure out how to piece it together themselves, right? The data, you know, individual components of technology in a data center in and of themselves aren't necessarily complex. It's all the connections between them that throw off the complexity and the risk. And so that's really our focus and our approach to computing. Anybody can bend sheet metal, right, around these components. What we're really focused on is an operational environment that we can deliver as a service to our customers so they can manage these fleets at scale.
Right, and I think that's one of the things that I've always liked about Cisco's approach to the market. And I think one of the ones that you guys are talking about, and there's collaboration with Red Hat, is around the AI pods as well. Why don't you kind of give us an understanding of that?
Yeah, so AI pods kind of came out of our Cisco validated design program, meaning, you know, if you present a solution and a customer wants to buy it, they say, well, what do I buy? And then, well, you need some sort of bundling mechanism. So like, it all kind of came together, like, okay, if we need to bundle, but we also need this specific function around AI, and we started with inferencing, and you can imagine we'll spread our wings a little bit as time goes on. So the validated design program really proof points this. So a typical validated design takes about 3 months of, you know, effort between XYZ companies to make sure everything works. And then AI pods are kind of the foundation. And if you look where Cisco is really going with the, you know, the secure AI factory story, you know, that we have with NVIDIA, AI pods are a component within that, meaning I can scale my AI pods, but still have this very uniform approach that overlays and includes security at every single layer to form an AI factory. So that's kind of the building blocks, right, and the components that we have.
And we're our ability to bring security and observability to that, I think, is unique. So there's going to be a lot of work.
Yeah, we're doing a lot of work with the Splunk team. So, you know, obviously pretty big acquisition for us, a year or so ago.
Not that big at all. I mean, just a couple
billion. It might have impacted the bonuses. I don't know. a great acquisition for us, but it also gives us an opportunity to really expose the entire stack, not just the Cisco stack, but all the way up through, you know, the NVIDIA NVIDIA stack. So, we're working very closely within the CVD program and within AI pods to make sure that visibility and observability is delivered with Splunk.
Yeah. I mean, you also have AppD, and you have a number of other things, ThousandEyes and all of that stuff that comes together. Because I look at it, I also spent some time at a hyperscaler, and to me, one of the things that was always the hardest piece, even inside a hyperscaler, was the networking and getting all of the microservices and everything to talk together. Has that been, have you seen that that is people leaned into these, to the pods in that way, into the Cisco validated designs, because it brings that full stack and you have the heritage of networking as well?
Definitely. I think, and I don't want to be on Splunk again, but yeah. You know, with the Observer, they do have APM functionality that's built in, and we're certainly taking advantage of that with, you know, the NVIDIA blueprints. You know, NVIDIA launched those blueprints, you know, 9 months or so. We've got them deployed, RAG blueprints, Avatar, you know, the human experience. And we're exposing those all through Splunk. So you can see, you know, where is there an issue? Do I need to potentially, you know, increase the size of the GPUs that are made available to this, you know, to this model, or X number of models, right? It's never just one anymore. So, yeah, I think, you know, being able to expose it. But if you adopt a uniform approach to your infrastructure and also to your application stack, it just makes, obviously, everything cleaner from an operations perspective, which allows you to really, you know, get more granular in what you see.
And automation's a key part of this, right? And that's another huge intersect for us with Red Hat around Ansible.
Yep.
And so he's being very, very modest here in what his team does. Not only are they kind of doing the testing to ensure that it's a validated, it works, it's also sizing, right? And so we have an AI advisor, right, that we have, where we can kind of put in all the parameters that relate to the AI workload that you're going to run, right? So tokens, response time, concurrent users, all those things. And the testing work that Chris's team has done allows us to translate that into a very prescriptive bill of materials for the infrastructure you're going to need to, you know, do that in a performant way, right?
Yep.
And no surprises, right? IT teams do not want surprises, they want predictability. And so all the work that we invest in our solutioneering that Chris leads up is pivotal to that.
I think we have been doing a lot of work, you know, with an Ansible automation platform team. We're trying to augment the collections that are available within the Red Hat platforms so that day two operations are just going to become cleaner. And obviously, focusing on OpenShift bare metal and OpenShift virtualization is the top priorities, and exposing, you know, infrastructure functionality around the GPUs for sure.
And viewers can learn more at Cisco Live in just a couple of weeks.
That's right.
Excellent.
Got a lot of sessions.
Yeah, we'll have Bob Liberté there attending as an analyst. And I think, you know, again, we love that. It's a great event as well. So
looking forward to having you there.
Excellent. Chris, Todd, thank you so much for coming up, for returning to theCUBE, I should say.
Thank you.
Always a delight having you. I'm Rebecca Knight for Rob Strechay. Stay tuned for more of theCUBE's live coverage of Red Hat Summit Ansible Fest. You're watching theCUBE, the leader in enterprise tech news and analysis.